Every year, my family would get together for July 4th in Bristol, Rhode Island. It was a big deal, because Bristol boasts the longest-running 4th of July parade in the country. We'd watch the parade from the lawn of Linden Place. This big white mansion used to belong to my relatives. It's right in the center of town. This is me, age two, with my mother and grandmother. Here's me, age three, bossing my brother around. My DeWolf ancestors were known as the Great Folk in Bristol. There were professors and writers, artists and architects, and many Episcopal ministers. I was proud to be related to them. I was also drawn to this fairy tale world of old New England. These images of my grandparents when they were young. It never occurred to me to ask how we got so established. One day my grandmother traced back. I was in seminary when I got a booklet in the mail that she wrote for all her grandchildren. She shared our family history, all the happy days. She also explained that the first DeWolf, Mark Anthony, came to Bristol as a sailor in 1744. And then she wrote, "I haven't stomach enough to describe the ensuing slave trade." What hit me hard was the realization that I already knew this. Knew, but somehow buried it along the way. What no one in my family realized was that the DeWolfs were the largest slave trading family in U.S. history. They brought over 10,000 Africans to the Americas in chains. 500,000 of their descendants could be alive today. This is me in my apartment in Boston. My name's Katrina Brown. I'm getting ready for a trip. A journey, really. I decided to retrace the slave trade route of my ancestors. From Rhode Island to Ghana to Cuba and back. I invited relatives to come with me, so we could reckon with this history together as a family. It felt like more than I could take on by myself. It's the week of July 4th, 2001.
Wow.
Oh, yes.
Boy, we figured if anybody was going to be late.
Hi. I tracked down 200 DeWolf descendants from all over the country and contacted them about coming on this trip. 9 people signed up. We range from siblings to 7th cousins. Many of us are actually meeting for the first time. DeWolfs have been going to St. Michael's Church for over 250 years. They wanted us to come here, too.
Can
The church was pretty much new to me, because I grew up in Philadelphia, where I was steeped in America's democratic ideals. In Bristol, it seems like the DeWolfs were the founding fathers. They were everywhere in the church. They even paid for the stained glass. My mind was swirling with all kinds of questions. What would we have to face on this trip? How would we have to rethink our sense of home and who we are today? But more importantly, what could we do as DeWolf descendants to help repair the enormous harm that our ancestors caused?
One of the rules that we felt in the family was what we call the no-talk rule. And it's very big. You don't talk about unpleasant things. There's a line in one of our family books that one of our ancestors said that we should never talk about sex. What were the other
things?
Religion.
I think politics.
Politics.
Right. And the last one was, and the Negroes. Yeah. That was the last one.
Out of the 200 people I wrote to about this project, 140 didn't respond at all. Of those who did respond, a few expressed concerns, but very politely. Only one person shared directly how totally upset he was. Basically, he's not trying to deny what happened. He's just worried that his black colleagues will change how they treat him, and black activists will suggest he has to pay. He doesn't think that's fair because he didn't do anything. Lyndon Place was also concerned about our journey. The mansion was built in 1810 by George DeWolf, one of the two most prominent slave traders in the family. Lyndon Place stayed in family hands until 1989, when it was turned into a museum. Some museum board members were worried about advertising this connection of Lyndon Place to slavery. They didn't let us film inside, so we just passed by.
And inside the fan lights, there's little angels.
Fan lights?
Yes, they're kind of like nymphs.
I guess it was later when the house had already become a museum. I read a pamphlet about the history of the house, and there was like two or three sentences about the DeWolf brothers being slave traders, and it was very much in this sort of jovial style, like the good old boys did a little bit of this thing.
It was the same for me when I was growing up. I heard of the DeWolfs as pirates, adventuring on the high seas. My great-grandfather painted this mural with a whole sweep of Bristol's history, as if it was all a children's story. So when my grandmother told me about our family being in the slave trade, at first I was totally shocked. But in the next instant, I realized I already knew about this past. It was right there, hidden in plain view.
Talking about history, I feel the heaviness of pulling generations between slave trade business and now. And it just feels like a heavy load of repression. What kind of crazy partnership do we have to silence?
some guilt. Some members of the family certainly feel guilt and feel very weighted down by it. I'm very fortunate in that I don't.
My grandfather died when my dad was 2. We don't know anything about any of this, and you know, we're descended from a different leg of this family, and so it's, you know, there's no amnesia, there's no guilt, there's no nothing. It didn't exist.
I think I've gone through a whole cycle a couple of times through, and one part of the cycle is to say, this is really not my family when you think about it. I'm just a little piece of this. I have one drop of this family, but I'm just really not a DeWolf at all.
The Perrys went to visit an old family cemetery. They found the gravestone of an enslaved African.
This is Adjoa, DeWolf.
Yes.
Oh, isn't that, look at that. Is that him or her?
And no birth date.
74.
James DeWolf purchased 2 children on the African coast, Adjoa and Polydore, and gave them to his wife as Christmas presents. There's even a nursery rhyme that's been passed on.
Adjoa and Polydore sitting in the cellar door. Polydore and Adjoa sitting in the cellarway. Down fell the cellar door, bump went Polydore. Up flew the cellarway, off flew Adjoa.
It wasn't until I got into all this that I found out that not only did the North dominate the U.S. slave trade, but slavery itself was legal here for over 200 years. There weren't many large-scale plantations. Instead, folks in the North would own 1 or 2, maybe 3 slaves. The enslaved Africans would do work like building stone walls. They say there were enough stone walls in early New England to reach farther than the moon. There's an old document in Newport, a petition from a local merchant. He was asking city council to kindly remove the slave whipping post from outside his storefront because blood was getting on his windows.
If I try to get into my ancestors' boots, I find it very difficult. The stomach for violence must have been extraordinary.
What they did was strikingly evil, but these people were probably not all that much different from all of us. If we were there at that time, some of us may well have been involved in the slave trade. And I think that's something we've got to come to grips with.
We're using our glasses here 150 years, 200 years after these people are dead. I don't want to defend anything that happened in this family or in New England or in America. But I don't want to vilify it, these people either. Because I don't know, I wasn't walking in their shoes.
Down at the harbor is James DeWolf's warehouse. This is where rum went out and sugar and molasses came in. James is the one who really masterminded the family takeover of all aspects of the trade. By the end of his life in 1837, he was supposedly the 2nd richest man in the United States.
When my first son was born, I had a real question of, do I inflict this on one more generation? Will this be a burden for my son to be James DeWolf Perry VI? And I chose to do it. It's hard to break a chain like that once it's started.
Bonnie Warren, a local historian, took us around.
James is a very smart man. He is savvy enough to know how to make money, how to change, how to roll with the times. In our world today, we have a Bill Gates. I mean, James Wolfe is brilliant. He knew how to do political, he knew how to get political favors to help his business. He also knew when to change and how to redirect. And he was, in his own way, extremely generous. So it's a very...
What strikes me is that this was big business. They made a lot of money at this. In economics, it's called vertical integration, controlling all aspects of an industry. But the bottom line is they really figured this out, and they seem to have made tremendous profits.
I had not realized that three generations of the family were involved in it, so it went on for a long time, which is embarrassing. You would have thought they would have gotten it, that this really isn't something that should have been done. And they called themselves Christians at the same time.
It was a high risk and a high return, because if you hit it well, you made a great deal of money.
That's what I'm trying to understand. So the slave trade, people expected a 25% return.
Very high.
And so you had not just one person, you had a town of people who were invested in this trade.
Shares. Yes.
Who's not involved? I mean, was there anyone around that was not involved in some way, either by directly or indirectly, through the purchases they made, through the investments they made?
I think, in general, the whole town was supporting what was going on here. And that's a very, very good question.
The more historians we talked to, the more sobering it got.
The slave trade, you got to remember, is not just a few people taking a boat and sending it out. Everyone in town lived off slavery. The boat makers, the iron workers who make the shackles, the coopers who made the barrels to hold the rum, the distillers who took the molasses and sugar and made it into rum. So literally the whole town was dependent on the slave trade.
All of the North was involved. All these cities and towns along the coast, Salem, Boston, Providence, New London, New Haven, New York, and the rural areas around them, either traded slaves or manufactured goods or raised farm products for the slave trade.
It was John Adams who said, "I don't know why we should blush to confess that molasses was an essential ingredient in our independence." And he could have very well extended the quote to say molasses, sugar, and the slave labor that produced this commerce.
At the Bristol Historical Society, tucked away in a corner on the second floor, there was a file cabinet full of DeWolf papers. These eerie records revealed the details of the logical economic model that the DeWolfs developed from 1769 to 1820. Here's how they made it work. First, they got the financing together. They recruited fellow townspeople to buy shares in their voyages, and eventually started their own bank. They also started an insurance company to cover the risk. Rum was the prime currency of the slave trade, so James acquired a distillery from his father-in-law. The DeWolfs also purchased ships, mostly from builders in Rhode Island and Massachusetts. The ships took rum to the Guinea coast to trade for Africans. July 4th, 1795, bought 9 prime slaves, 1 woman and 8 men, and paid for them tobacco, rum, hats, bread, mackerel. Many of the enslaved Africans were brought to work on plantations that the DeWolfs established in Cuba. These plantations supplied sugar and molasses needed to make the rum back in Bristol. They also served as holding places for Africans while the DeWolfs waited for slave prices to go up at auction. Havana, September 11th, 1806. John DeWolf of Bristol. Sale of 121 Negroes. Total income, $36,300, which today equals $553,000. The largest number of slaves were sold in Havana and Charleston. But Rhode Island slavers did business in more than 40 markets in the West Indies, North, and South America. Rhode Island became the state most complicit in the American slave trade. Rum, Africans, sugar, rum. The efficient wheels of the triangle trade were set in motion again and again.
Or fetters?
I don't manacles know. Or what?
Leg irons.
Oh.
I don't know.
Legs.
Oh,
or
point.
Big hands.
Good point. So, I mean, diving in and sort of going, oh, that many slaves. Oh, with this kind of condition in our slave boat. Oh, with things like this around their hands and their arms. When you get down to the concrete level of recreating the reality in your mind, where you really have to, you know, you really have to sort of get the, you know, the heart impact, because then you can,
Nobody wanted to ever talk about this, and it made everybody very uncomfortable. What these people are used to doing is presenting this pretty picture of who the DeWolfs were and taking people through Linden Place and pointing out the nice portraits and the beautiful chandeliers, and everyone goes, oh, how lovely, what a beautiful home. I wish it was mine. I'd like to have this as my living room. And that's the extent of it.
I just want to say a thing about name, because it's huge. The name, mm-hmm. DeWolf. Mm-hmm. Don't soil the name. That's the message I'm getting. The bottom line is don't soil it.
Probably all Bristol feels that.
Yeah.
I imagine that it's sullying Bristol.
Hey, we heard that word. I heard that word. Mm-hmm. And I still didn't think slave trading.
Well, if there was a sign coming into town that said you're entering Bristol, the historic center of U.S. slave trading, things would be very different.
James DeWolf was so loved by people in Bristol that for years after his death, they'd bring out his coach for the parade. He used to ride the coach to Washington, where he served as a U.S. senator. Here it is in the 1930s, marching along with proud Bristolians who preferred not to remember the slave trade. Instead, together with the rest of the North, they created an identity as heroic abolitionists and founding patriots. Growing up, I fell in love with that story. And then there's one more detail. The slave trade was illegal for most of the time the DeWolfs were practicing it. To maneuver around the law, they secured a political favor from none other than President Thomas Jefferson, whose campaign they'd supported. Jefferson appointed their brother-in-law as Bristol's customs official. This man always happened to be looking the other way as DeWolf ships went in and out of harbor.
My fears about going to Ghana are that it won't mean a lot to me.
Seemed like an intense week to me.
Been very.
I will see where the slaves were imprisoned, and it won't come alive for me. And my other fear is that it will come alive for me.
Thank you very much. Correct.
Yes, you can please count.
I was shocked to find out there'd been over 70 slave forts on the West African coast. Europeans elbowed each other for control of the coast for centuries. Everybody was here. From Spain and France, to Holland, England, even Denmark. We came to Elmina and Cape Coast Castle. Our family had been here before. At the forts, we met with Kofi Annan Dohou. He's a revered poet in Ghana.
You know, the Portuguese were the first to land here. But sometime, for the slave boats that arrived here, there were Christian missionaries on board. When you start our tour, you'll find that on top of the dungeon, there is a church. One of the first things that would be done to you when you are captured was to be baptized. You lose your name and take a Christian name. You become a slave in the name of God.
A lot of what I was feeling was numbness, a difficulty in getting in touch with what must it have been like for these people. I'm also finding that I'm more in touch with the experience of my ancestors than that of the Africans who were being so badly mistreated. We were in the room where James DeWolf must have been negotiating to buy slaves.
July 6th, 1795. Bought one man boy slave. Paid for him rum. Six handkerchiefs for the women slaves.
It's important to compare the space we are going into here, which was reserved, the space we are coming from, which was reserved for the governor and his visitors, his guests, to the space here that was reserved for as many as 1,000 people who were already in chains.
Five rooms,
yeah,
five. 15 feet by 30 feet,
yeah.
And that's 1,000 people.
Oh, 1,000 people.
I think what is also important is the just the psychology of being kept here in this darkness with the sea roaring in the background. You are dealing with people who have never had anything to do with the sea. Many of them are coming from inland, you know, 100, in some cases, 1,000 miles away. And it's also known that in most cases, the actual time of arrival here would be time to be in the night. And then get into this enclosed space with the darkness.
Cockroaches were crawling on the walls. There was something unspeakable about the packed earth floor.
We've done that which has been asked of us, yet there's room for more. But we pray that the Spirit of Almighty God and the Spirit of our ancestors accept this humble token and symbolism of our paying tribute to them and never letting their memory nor their legacy die. May they live forever.
The thing that I guess strikes me more than anything right now is that we've talked when we were in Bristol and we were in Providence and we're listening to historians and scholars and we've heard people talk about, you know, you've got to place it in the context of the times and this is the way things were done and this is how, you know, life was. And I sit in that dungeon and I say bullshit. It was an evil thing, and they knew it was an evil thing, and they did it anyway. And I couldn't have said that before, before tonight.
We came to Ghana during a festival called Panafest. People of African descent had come from all over. From Jamaica, Suriname, from the United States. There were ceremonies to remember suffering and to celebrate survival. There was a procession of tribal chiefs. I had the weirdest feeling. I realized that some of their ancestors might have been slave traders. They could have even traded with my family. We brought this up with a Ghanaian historian.
One of the comments that is often made is that, well, we didn't start it. the tribal leaders in Africa started it.
That is not true.
Would you comment on
that? You see, first of all, we should acknowledge the fact that slavery is not peculiar to Africa. Every civilization, from Mesopotamia through China, India, ancient Greece, Rome, has known slavery. Secondly, remember that those who participated in the slave trade, from the African point of view, were not the ordinary people. As the European records indicate, they were the kings, the principal men, the wealthy people.
What Panafetan has allowed for us to do is bring about the healing necessary to unite our cultural nation and political nation so that this will never happen again.
Everything was starting to feel awkward now. We definitely stood out. At one of the forts, Dane tried to introduce himself to an African-American woman, but she refused his hand. She said she was hoping not to see any white people here. It was confusing. I was starting to feel like we were intruding on sacred ground. Some family members weren't as concerned as I was. They joined a ceremony at the river at Asin Mansu. This is where middlemen would bring captured Africans for a last bath after marching them from inland. The captives were washed and oiled, primed for sale at the coast.
The goddess of this river carried downstream all of our sorrows, all of our pain, all of our madness, all those insanities we collected during that period of time.
After a few days at Panafest, I just wanted us to get away, to take a break from all the intensity. We went to a nature preserve called Kakum Park.
When I stood at the door of No Return in the dark in that fort, that experience felt like I, in fact, did carry some guilt for it. I renounce that with my mind, but my heart says something else.
I think certainly the most humbling experience that I've had on the trip has been that situation with the African-American woman at the fort. I fully understand where it comes from, but I've never had that experience before. And I also felt a little bit of guilt of having invaded some space that she considered very, very precious and valuable to her.
When we're treated unkindly or given the cold shoulder, despite understanding where that's coming from, when we're treated that way, we get anger. When we have that anger, where do we go with the anger? I think that's one question. But the other question is, where should their anger be directed? Because I don't think that they shouldn't necessarily have anger, but it needs to be, I don't know, it just generates more anger. It's one of those things like, you know, Israel and Palestine. You wonder whether it will ever end if it goes on that way. And so.
Yeah.
The park ranger gave us a classic tour. He told us about trees and animals and traditional foods. And then he went on to explain how people name their kids in Ghana.
What is happening is that we Ghanaians, especially the Akans, we do give our names according to the day being born. When born on Monday, male, they call you Kwejo, female, Ajua, Tuesday, Abra or Kwabra.
There's a the female name on Monday, Ajue.
Ajua.
Polydor.
Yeah. One of the slaves who was brought to Rhode Island to work for our ancestors, her name was Ajua. Yeah.
So now we know she was born on Monday.
Yeah, exactly. She was born on Monday.
Yeah.
Okay, we move on.
I've met two people named Ajua.
Ajua and Polydor sitting in the cellar room. Polydor and Ajua sitting in the cellar room. Down cellar room. Bump.
Your ancestors, did they bought our people with a lot of money?
I'm sorry, I didn't catch it.
I said, did your ancestors bought our people, our ancestors, with a lot of money?
In the olden days.
Did they buy them with a lot of money? No.
The white people, they lied to us that they are coming to make friends and trade with us. Instead of that, what they said, they came and make us slaves. Are you not ashamed of coming here?
What? Am I not ashamed? Yeah, I am ashamed. Yeah. It's a shame. It is a shaming thing.
Tension never seemed to go away. But we all really wanted to have conversations with people. So I arranged for space at the Cape Coast Town Hall. Many Ghanaians and African Americans showed up to talk to us. We'd been inviting people over the last couple days as we met them at different events.
Thank you so much, everyone, for coming. My name is Juanita Brown, and I'm the consulting producer for this film.
My colleague Juanita helped plan this whole trip.
Many of you have come.
She came on the trip to lead discussions like this one.
Why don't you say your first question?
Do you think the slave trade actually made the whites feel superior? And do you all whites here feel superior while you are sitting with us?
That's a wonderful question for me. I can say uncategorically no, I do not. But I grew up in the South, in South Carolina, in Charleston. And back in the 40s and the 50s, Charleston was a terribly racist community. And I was terribly racist. Was it the environment that I was in? Absolutely. Was it more than that? I don't know, and that thought scares me. And I may be afraid to dig for that answer. I feel very proud, frankly, that I have been able to overcome as much of that as I have.
I'm curious, and I want to know, do you really, really think that you've shed every single bit of the racial categorization and the racialization and the racism? I mean, do you really think it's possible that that's where you are? Because I know a lot of black folks who would think that that wasn't true.
And I would think that wasn't true also. I'm not sure that I said it was completely gone. Largely overcome. Let me narrow that down a little bit. Do I feel that I have shed it all? There's no way.
I don't think it can all ever be shared.
I'm a different generation from Dane, so I didn't grow up around extreme racism. But I still feel so separate from Black Americans, mostly because of fear. I'm afraid of moments like this, so I was glad Dane was on the spot, not me.
Make it a point to go to a Black play or a Black concert or something like that, so you can see how it feels.
See, that's hard.
That is hard. That is hard. But I have to do it every day. When I go to a conference, I'm the only Black person sitting in that conference. Is it easy? No, but I have to do it. You have to do it in order to feel and to get that sensitivity. Then you'll learn to step out.
Are you willing to talk about reparations? Are you willing to talk about other kinds of programs? Not just when you come conscious of it and you go through the process of accepting it and then normalizing yourself. What then?
Slave ship captains would spend several months trading on the coast. Once their ships had full cargoes of captured Africans, they'd set sail. We flew on a red eye. Underneath us, for one night, were the waters of the Middle Passage. Over 11 million Africans were transported across the Atlantic. 1.5 million of them died on this horrendous journey. Many Rhode Island ships came to Havana. In my mind, Cuba was about Castro and old American cars. I never knew that Havana was one of the largest slave markets in the world. For decades, Northerners came here from Africa, flaunting their state laws. Some continued even after the federal ban in 1808, when the U.S. as a whole abolished the slave trade. The island was a real hub for illegal traders. The DeWolfs developed 5 sugar and coffee plantations on the island to reap more profits and create greater control of their own triangle of commerce. Hoyle Lepique, a research librarian, showed us a map that had the names of DeWolf plantations on it. I was struck by the date on the map, 1875. Long after the Civil War and abolition, and the family might have still owned plantations down here. We set off to find one of the plantations. So much had happened there. I wondered what was left today. On our way, I thought we should try to get a feel for the lives of enslaved Africans.
Here we go.
would mark the start of the work day.
Dr. Marsh.
It seemed like a good idea at first, but it only got more and more absurd. It culminated with a so-called slave meal. We were served five courses of food that slaves supposedly ate.
I feel real, I feel a lot of confusion, a lot of emotion. I'm having a real problem with, I don't know what to call it, the itinerary. It just feels way out of balance to me. How it's feeling right now is that it's going to show up as a really neat travelogue about slavery. But damn, I need to have us connect more between each other on a feeling level. A lot is going on between us, and we're just being our nice Protestant selves, and I'm sick of it.
I'm having a lot of the same feelings, that we're doing all kinds of interesting things, and I mean, I'm real interested in Ghana and I'm real interested in Cuba, but here's a group of 10 people who seem to be together ready to talk about race in the United States, and we're not talking about it. And I want to talk about, what do we do when we go home? What do we do when this is over? And
maybe I wasn't setting things up right. But now it was obvious. We needed to sit down and talk.
Two races must be able to cry together. For true redemption to take place, for true peace to take place, if the hurt of the abused is unable to forgive the perpetrator, there will never be the kind of peace or redemption that we need to have in the world.
Whites don't even talk about race. How can we ask for forgiveness from black people?
I'm not asking for forgiveness today. I'm saying down the road.
We can't have any expectations.
I don't hear anyone saying that they expect forgiveness. Certainly not.
But we do have somebody saying that if we don't get it, it's not going to work, which is pretty much the same damn thing.
Dane's saying eventually.
You know, I agree from like a, you know, human, theological, emotional level. I totally agree with that, but I think it's not for us to say that until we've done everything in our power to apologize in word and deed. And then step two is that it's for black Americans to decide what they want to do with that.
We kept arguing. Should we be more focused on talking with white people or black people?
I'm afraid this very quickly becomes a lot of whites talking to each other, doing this. I would hope most people would agree that there's always the danger of becoming self-indulgent.
What I'm hoping that you have been hearing is every single black person that's talked to us has said exactly that. You white people need to talk to white people. That's what they've said.
I want to know what you mean by self-indulgent.
Oh, great.
What do you mean by that?
Absolutely.
Because...
I'm worried about a bunch of white people thinking very hard about their ancestors and what the slave trade meant to them, and the danger that in isolation we can start trying to assuage our sense of guilt and shame because we've decided we've dealt with it and feel better about it, rather than dealing with the consequences, the living consequences today.
For me, talking like this with each other was a way to assuage guilt. It's true. But in a good way, it was a first step, like getting therapy. So then I'd be ready to tackle real issues in the world. All of a sudden, Ellie was upset. She wanted to talk to Juanita, who was in the room. Juanita didn't intend to be part of family discussions, so we wouldn't censor ourselves, and she wouldn't be put on the spot. But we all got close. So she decided to sit in. Now Ellie was worried about what it was like for her to listen to us. So a bit awkwardly, we all turned to Juanita.
You know, like, given all that's happened, and am I not angry? And the entire truth is that, you know, in this moment, you're just a good person to me. And also the truth, and of course I'm angry at white people, you know? I think white people have been cowards and have chosen to give up their integrity and their humanity for so long, knowing what's happened to my people. Like, it's ridiculous. If you grew up where I grew up, you'd be pissed off, you know? Anybody who's alive, you know, or who's paying attention should be pissed off, you know? And the fact that white people are not pissed off means that they're not paying attention. So, I mean, that's, and it's helpful for me. Like, the reason why I'm doing this is because it's important for me that white people take responsibility and that ultimately, it's about human liberation, and also it's about liberation of my people. It's about liberation of you guys. That's the truth.
We were ready to go home, but I still wanted us to get to George DeWolf's plantation. General George DeWolf was from the third generation of slave traders. He named his plantation Arca de Noé, Noah's Ark. I had the diary of the plantation overseer. On April 14th, 1821, he wrote, "The first Negro I struck was this evening for laughing at prayers." In another diary, there was a painting of Peter. This is the only image of an African owned by the DeWolves that I've been able to find. On February 24th, 1833, the overseer wrote, "Dear reader, I have not yet made you acquainted with Peter. Peter is our cook. You must see Peter. I will attempt a likeness. Peter, on rainbow legs, stalks round, something between a whale and a weasel."
Now, do we know that this was part of the plantation?
Yeah.
Yes.
We just don't know what building it was. You know, if this was the house or the slave quarters or
storage areas.
Or the mill or... I remember the description in the book talking about the proximity to the Gulf is such that he would be able to look out and see the ships come in. And this is during the illegal period. Linden Place is... the result of all that. Linden Place was built by George DeWolf from his fortune made during 1 year of the illegal trade.
You know, we don't spend a lot of time talking about these sorts of things in history class. This is kind of glossed over, and it's glossed over, it's kind of ignored. Slavery is brought up as a principal reason that the Civil War was fought, and the mighty North took care of that problem, and then on we go to the Industrial Revolution and flying at Kitty Hawk and then men on the moon. That's sort of how it goes. And
so let's just have some time where people can just be here and do whatever you need or want to do.
Let's piss on the building. Your ritual.
Mm-hmm. All that I'm aware of wanting to do is get out of here.
Yeah, I'm ready to go.
Let's go. The mosquitoes and heat were getting to me too, but I stayed. These abandoned ruins made history so close somehow. I couldn't help thinking about parallel universes. Comfortable New England versus what was going on down here. It was all starting to add up. In the 19th century, after the slave trade was outlawed, northern ships were bringing sugar and coffee from the islands and cotton from the southern states, all harvested by slaves. European immigrants processed these raw materials in textile mills and other factories all over the north. In exchange, equipment and supplies were sent southward, so that sugar press we'd seen was from Buffalo. Buffalo, New York. Fueling this commerce were ordinary consumers, rich, poor, and in between. People sitting in their homes in the abolitionist North, enjoying coffee and sugar. The suffering was out of sight and out of mind.
It's hard to say because I didn't live then, but you know, there's stuff that goes on today that we all accept as normal that isn't, and in 100 years, people might be looking at it the same exact way, you know? I buy stuff that's made by people that aren't getting paid what they're worth at all the time, you know?
After our 3-week journey, we were exhausted. But I was already worrying about what to do next. I didn't want us to go back to business as usual, as if this were just an expensive vacation we were coming home from. So after some time off, we got back together to think about next steps. But first, there were some other things to sort through.
Don't tell anybody.
Very planned meal to look upper class that is highly unlikely to represent any meal we would ever
not
have
sure
together.
Me.
Well,
not
yes,
sure for me.
Yes, and I had the same reaction Dane was. To me, I looked at this table and went, "Wow, boy, that looks rather pretentious."
So you guys wouldn't eat this type of food? This is fancier food than
I'd like to be more specific and say, Katrina, I hope that you will present us as we really are, instead of trying to caricature us into something we're not. I think back to when you were interviewing me. I've forgotten why the conversation went that way, but I said, after college, and you stopped me and asked me specifically to say Harvard.
Whereas he wouldn't have said Harvard.
My going to Harvard wasn't about privilege. I earned my way to Harvard.
You don't think going to Harvard is a privilege?
I think going to Harvard is a privilege, but I'd have gone to Harvard if I had grown up in a very different family.
I never could have imagined going
you
to Harvard.
You would have or you wouldn't have?
I would have.
Yeah.
I would have, because I taught myself to read before I was 4 years old. I worked my butt off at every level at school. I was...
But you can't assume if you were in a different family that you would have been in an environment that would have nurtured that.
I had plenty of classmates at Harvard who were in different families. It was schools where it was nurtured.
Your dad also went to Harvard?
Okay.
My dad worked for the phone company, and he went to night school to get his college degree. For me, it was the University of Oregon. Go Ducks. But when I sit back, I don't think you're lying. I don't. But when I think, okay, your dad went to Harvard, that's an up.
Didn't most of our parents go to, where did your dad go?
I'm either third or fourth generation Princeton.
So Princeton, Brown, Harvard, oh, Harvard, Harvard,
yeah,
Brown.
Yeah, we're representative of white America,
school,
aren't
wait.
We?
Night school.
Harvard.
Harvard. Yeah. Everybody but you.
Tom, I think you have a very important point.
Tom, is something you want to talk about?
I'm going to go eat in the kitchen.
Tom, the reason I'm stressing my background is precisely to make the point that you're making.
It's very interesting. I didn't realize.
Oh, my God. How much Harvard nothing like having to look at ourselves in the mirror. Gave
any advantage to legacy.
It's not surprising we were getting nervous about our privilege. Again, how to own up to it. I do think. What to do with it. The truth is, none of us inherited money directly from the slave trade. That was squandered long ago. But some in the family do have other inherited wealth. Railroad money, cotton money, coal, steel. And money or no money, we've stayed in the elite. Meanwhile, profits from the slave trade launched a lot of businesses, and many of them are still operating in the world today. Take Arkwright. James DeWolf helped start this textile mill in 1810. Generations of immigrants came to work here, and the company's still going strong. Now it's owned by a Dutch corporation. They're making copier and printer supplies. At this point, I decided we should dive directly into the question of reparations and reconciliation, as a result of that, of repair, basically. There were a lot of different theories and politics to sort through, and the national conversation was definitely heating up. Lawsuits were being filed against corporations. Some wanted Congress to take action. Others wanted official apologies. And for every idea, there were also loud voices of opposition. Then our names started showing up. To make sense of it all, we decided to meet with people in our home communities and to interview experts.
We may jointly come to some conclusions that, yeah, it may take some money to do some things, but there are some other things that have to happen too. Perhaps reparations is a process. It is not necessarily an event.
This is a movement which I fear, whatever the rightness of it in principle, will have the consequence of alienating more Americans than it will of enlisting sympathy for us.
My own view is that whatever proceeds come from reparations should be put into a trust fund that a commission will dispense that will focus on the needs of what I call the bottom stuck, those African Americans who are descendants of slaves who have never truly benefited from integration and who have never benefited from affirmative action and other programs designed to help. And if you think about that, whatever you think about reparations, if you think about if there's a remedy that solves the problem of the poorest of the poor, that's not a black remedy. That's an American remedy.
People haven't said it, but I just have a feeling that I have a lot of relatives who are wondering if you've thought about suing families for reparations.
The answer is that I'd love to have your 14 addresses. And I know where to find you, right? You know, the point of the matter is that who you sue is largely irrelevant. It's why. And I think that the who will identify themselves. Well, let me just tell you this. I think it's important that one of the successes of the reparations movement so far is that there have been defendants, and I describe that broadly, who have come forward to say, let's talk.
We were ready to show up for the larger conversation because we all wanted to make a difference, regardless of whether or not we should be accountable for our family's past. Each of us figured out our own approach. Jim decided to support reparations lawsuits.
To me, it's the only game in town. Nothing else is succeeding. Nothing else is working. I listened for years through the 1950s and 1960s to my father saying, wrong thing to do, wrong thing to do, wrong thing to do. We've got to wait. We've got to go slower. I think he was dead wrong.
To me, I think that for me, my role is encouraging that dialogue. Encouraging people not to be afraid to face that which divides us.
I would have the president issue a public apology. I would have Congress participate in that. I think that we should have truth and reconciliation discussions as they did in South Africa.
You see, I'm not at a place where I'm into enrolling people who are antagonistic. I'm into spending time with people who are white who really get that there's something to be done and want to do something about it.
Over time, I got more and more involved in the Episcopal Church. It felt really natural because our family had such a long history in the church. And now, in 2006, there was this great synchronicity. For years, Black Episcopalians and others have been calling on the church to deal with the legacy of slavery in the U.S. But there'd been resistance. Now, at the 75th General Convention, people were trying again. This time there were resolutions focused specifically on the church's own complicity in slavery. Tom, Dane, Ledley, and I went to convention to help push for the resolutions. We were starting to take public action together as a family. It was something I'd hoped for from the very first day of this journey.
The resolutions that are before us this morning call upon the Episcopal Church to acknowledge its sinful past, to apologize for it, and to seek detailed information about the economic benefits the Episcopal Church derived from slavery and its aftermath, and what we should do about that.
Yeah, what to do about it. That was the controversial part. The idea was for the church to embark on a 3-year process to figure out how to help repair the breach. That phrase was open-ended on purpose. The subtext was reparations.
Many African Americans are naturally drawn to say, never mind the healing dialogue, that doesn't feed my kids today. And that doesn't necessarily mean that people think checks to individuals are needed. Some do, but others would argue, and I agree, that what's needed is massive investment to deal with the unlevel playing field. Once you really start to face the history and open your heart, now that I've done that, I can say it actually becomes very natural to want to make things right, not out of personal guilt, but out of grief.
Reparations grow from the world of entitlements, but entitlements create second-class citizens and second-class members of the Episcopal Church.
The African slave trade was our Holocaust.
I would ask this committee to look at how we bridge the brokenness that has happened beyond the tangible to the spiritual, the brokenness of Africans and African Americans.
When I read the resolutions, I was deeply disappointed because I felt in them no sense of urgency. We're preparing for 3 years from now and forever after. But today is the day.
We're very good about being mindful of something in the Episcopal Church. It's time we did something.
On the very last day of the 9-day convention, after almost being put aside, the resolutions were finally brought to the floor.
All those in favor, 1, 2, 3.
The resolutions passed resoundingly.
I feel good about the fact that finally we have something. Mm-hmm. Finally we have a document. My lingering issue always is, are they going to do it? It's a guarded hope, mm-hmm. but it's a hope. Mm-hmm. So.
We'd covered a lot of ground by now. But there was still something I was avoiding. I felt like we needed to come back to Bristol to speak to people in town. The minister at St. Michael's invited me to be a guest preacher. It was Martin Luther King Sunday.
Morning. My name is Katrina Brown, and as many of you know,
so I spoke to them.
I'm a descendant of the DeWolfs, who date back to 1744.
I spoke about how this idyllic town has this horrible history, and how it can seem like, as white people, we have only two choices: either listen to African American calls to deal with the history, which can make us feel guilty and bad about ourselves, or shut it all out so we don't have to feel bad.
As we bring attention to the question of what will create wholeness for people of African descent, we can also ask what will create wholeness for us as people of European descent. What are the scars and legacies that we hold? They're different, but they're there.
In my head, I was wondering, what did this sound like to everybody? I had no idea.
When we were in Ghana, we attended a ceremony. It was at a river called Asinmansu. And there was an African American leader who was performing a ritual on people there to heal from the past. And my cousin Dane, who's here this morning, approached him and asked if he could perform the ritual for us as DeWolf descendants. And the man smiled and said, "I could do that. But I think you should ask your own elders to play that role." And I don't know exactly what the healing ritual would look like for us, but I do know that we'll figure it out together once we face the history. So let's bring all the stories out into the open, without anxiety or dread, but with the trust and hope and faith that are born of love. Amen.
The walk to my pew felt endless. There'd been no sounds or signs of anything during my sermon, sounds of encouragement or disapproval. I was full of doubt. But then something unexpected happened. And unexpected things never happen in normal Sunday service. In the spirit of my sermon, the minister, David Dobbins, invited people to come forward. And people got up. Everybody got up. Thank you.
One love, one life, when it's one need in the night. One love, we get to share it. It leaves you, baby, if you don't care for it.
After the service, it felt like something had shifted, opened, but things still felt unsettled. I knew there were long roads ahead.
And you want me to go without?
Well, on this journey, I've had to face how deep the divisions are, how deep the distrust. It can seem like we're so far from making things right. But in my heart, I have this strange feeling, as if we're already here, right here, just waiting for each other.
Have you come here for forgiveness? Have you come to raise the dead? Have you come here to play Jesus to the lepers in your head? Did I ask too much, more than a lot? You gave me nothing now, it's all I got. We're one, but we're not the same. Well, we hurt each other, and we're doing it again. You say love is a temple, love a higher law. Love is a temple, love the higher law. You ask me to enter, but then you make me crawl. And I can't be holding on to what you've got when all you've got is hurt. One love, one blood, one life. You've got to do what you should. One life with each other, sister, brothers. One life, but we're not the same. We get to carry each other, carry each other. One.